But I want to thank Terry personally for his mentorship and his friendship and his leadership of my career and the impact that he had on my life. And then to see all of this and to spend time with Marissa and Scott yesterday and understand what he is doing for all of retail, you know, with the Terry Lundgren School for Retailing, and the legacy that you are building and that you are leaving and that you are continuing is just a testament. So from the small and working with careers to something big with involving a lot of people's careers, congratulations to Mr. Lundgren. Give him a hand. So what we're going to talk about today is reimagining Macy's, and that's my job and it's my topic. And I want to tell you how we're looking at it and where we're headed. So I think we can all agree that it's a tough environment. And at Macy's, we are looking outward as much as we're looking inward for the solutions and how we're going to solve this. It's a very competitive landscape. Certainly, the U.S. consumer spending is increasing, but it's changing. And it's basically going to different things in many cases and being spent in different places. The competition is intensifying. And I think with pricing transparency, it's changing the whole notions of value. And when you look at what the internet has done and what off-price is doing, all retailers are on their heels right now about what that means for our products and the experiences that we offer. There's huge seismic shifts that are happening in the patterns and formats that by which we do retail. You all know about the amount of square footage per capita in the United States. It's quite high. We probably have too much retail square footage. And you've got new emerging concepts like off-price and outlet and vendor direct and certainly the pure plays that are all popping in. So this is when you look at department stores and you look at all of our competitors, pure play, you can see the list there. This is how it feels today to a department store. But I would tell you also that we're not discouraged, you know, because we have listened to our customers, we're certainly reading the data and listening to our customers better than ever before, and we're seeing the possibilities. So let me give you a couple of stats that give us encouragement. First one is that 90% of consumers are likely to purchase something when they're directly involved with a sales associate. So it's gonna drive this whole, I know that the conference yesterday, we talked a lot about experience. The opportunity for experience is bigger than ever because when you do have an associate that is dealing with somebody on chat, or they're dealing with somebody in a store, 90% likely to purchase something. 36% of our customers still do not wanna wait for a product to ship. So this opportunity for all retailers, certainly omnichannel retailers, to work on buy online, pick up in store, that's definitely a buzzword. Everybody is talking about how we're gonna shift demand from online and that demand have it fulfilled out of a store, buy online, pick up on store, because 36% don't want it to arrive on their doorstep or wait for the shipping. And believe it or not, we still have a big chunk of our customers that enjoy the recreation of shopping. So that should give all of us brick and mortar retailers some encouragement. So then we have this whole opportunity with technology, and I think we all know that our customers don't just adopt technology, but they absorb it. And technology drives these fundamental changes in our consumers and how they interact with brands and how they interact with each other. And you can see on the left side here how they browse, how they transact, how they build relationships with brands, and how they share their opinions. And when you flip over to the right side of the page, what that happens in social media, and how an incident in a particular store can get magnified very quickly. And so what we say and what we do as a company is very, very important because the reaction to it is immediate and it is far reaching. So let's also, when you talk about the technology, let's also talk about the consumer trends. We talked earlier about how they look at values and this pricing transparency. Having something that is a product, and you can see it happening, the commoditization of products that do not have discrete distribution. And when you see that, you're seeing everything kind of driving down into a very low price. We're earning and keeping customers' brand loyalty is more difficult than ever. Customers do not shop by brand anymore. They shop for some brands, but they don't buy it head to toe. Their loyalty to particular retail brands is in many cases diminishing. And they all have higher expectations on customer experience. So how we figure that out, how we continue to invest in technology, but then also make sure that we have the dollars there to build into customer experience in our stores is very, very important. And I think what we know is that the experience for our millennial population and our Gen Z is even more requiring. They expect more of a store experience. So I think that the world has changed for everyone. The definition of value is different for everyone, and the bar on experience has raised for everyone. That's our consumer today. So let's talk a little bit about Macy's, and I'll talk about some of our assets. We have big assets because we have a very broad audience. 54% of America shopped at Macy's last year. So they bought something in either online or one of our stores. And this is a tremendous opportunity that we have with to delight or disappoint the consumer each and every day. So we have to keep that in mind when I talk later about the whole notion of scale. So I'm going to show you something about our best customers, because any good strategy, you have to make choices. And at Macy's, we have chosen to focus on our best customers. And let me tell you about our best customer, and then I'm going to show you a video of who she is. So 70% of our consumers are female. That's not a surprise. But it's also a very high, 30% is a high percentage of male consumers. And when you look at our market share in the men's area, it's why our men's business is so strong, is because we have a very high complement of our customer base, our male. And when you look at the male and female, the video we're going to see is really on the female side. But these people are very confident, they're very optimistic and social, and these are just words. These are all tested, these are all how they compare to other shoppers. We'll show you what we mean by that. And one of the things that I take great heart in working for a brand is that they want Macy's to succeed. Those that are with us that are our core shoppers, you know, they love Macy's, but there's other customers that may not like us, we may have disappointed them, but they want our brand to succeed. We're part of the fabric of American life. And that's a big responsibility, but it also gives us a big opportunity. So let me do what I'd love to do is just introduce you to our best customer, and then we'll talk about her in a moment. So let's cue best customer.
If you think about the heart and soul of who Macy's talks to and who their shopper is, she is the fashionable spender. And we know that the fashionable spender is, you know, has a great kind of profile for us. She's younger, she's more diverse, she loves shopping. But there's more to her than just shopping. She's very distinctive versus your competitive set. She's much more likely to say that she's optimistic. She's much more spontaneous. She's much more likely to kind of say, you know, I'm not comfortable with conformity. She's much more likely to say, hey, I've got lots of friends and I make friends really easily. I have people friending me on Facebook all the time. She's more likely to describe herself as adventurous and daring and fashionable. She's an incredibly confident and expressive and extrovert woman. And I kind of love her. I mean, she's really, you kind of have to love her. You know, she's like your friend that always starts the party, that is kind of magnetic and kind of everyone's rallying around and gathering around. She's the one who, like, you call when you've had a breakup because she's going to cheer you up and take you for margaritas. She's just this awesome, awesome woman. And that's who you have walking through your doors. And you know, you should love her and embrace her and be inspired by her and how she lives her life.
I love an excuse to buy like a new dress.
Holidays are a big thing, but also like promotions, I mean a breakup.
Anyone's birthday. Birthdays are important.
I make a big deal about those things because I think it's special and it should be acknowledged.
It's about like love and family and togetherness.
Anything that requires like we need to get the wine out and we need to celebrate, you know, which can't even be a Friday.
I find that I've reward myself weekly.
Say I had a really productive day at work. You can like go shopping or just like small things.
It just feels good to express the gratitude for what you've earned, you know, by treating yourself to a little something.
And our family always gets together in the house and we all dress up like if we're going to the mall. You should see us in New Year's just to go to an apartment.
So how many of you are one or her? So I'm thin as I can see. There's a lot of her, and I will tell you that we're listening to her more than ever. You know, Terry's always said, you know, put the center, you know, the customer at the center of all of our decisions, and we now have the opportunity through data and consumer insights. We put a lot of horsepower in talent against those two subjects, and we're mining that data like never before. So we have a treasure trove of this customer data. We're digging into it. We're listening. We also have a very developed field organization of experts that through the My Macy's organization that we've built over the past 10 years that are telling us at a specific door level what's important to that customer, how she's changing, and what she expects of us. So this analytics and insights team is really moving us forward, and they're really helping us understand this best customer. We're using this data to share with our brand partners. It's helping us speed our decision making. It's helping us design all of our in-store tests. And I'll talk about three of them later that are very helpful for us in getting at growth and opportunities to delight this best customer. We're iterating more quickly than ever. and we're course correcting where we need to. I think through it all is that we're getting one single version of the truth. We're aligning around the same facts. We're looking at the same view of our opportunities. We're sharing that with our vendor communities that are very hungry to hear from this. I mean, you can imagine the amount of data that we have for the broad customer set that we have. That information is very powerful when you work with your partners to get at the right solutions. We're moving forward for those solutions. But through all that, data gets you a lot of the way. But it doesn't, and particularly when you're in a desire business like ours. I mean, nobody needs a new X or Y when you're talking about apparel and accessories. We are in the business of creating the desire. So it really is this great balance between art and science, or it's this great balance between data and instinct. That doesn't change. So the right strategy. We talked about competitive landscape and technology, consumer trends, passionately listening to our customer. And that has really led us to our strategy, and I'll show you a little bit of it. So we know if there are three things that we need to do is we need to, at Macy's, we need to stabilize our core business, which has been falling off in the last couple of years. We need to continue the strong growth of our digital and our mobile business, which has really been best in class. And we need to find new paths for growth in the future, set the foundation for that. So to that, we have a 5-point strategy. Three of those points are consumer-facing, and it's revolving around brand, our products, our experience. We'll talk about those today. One point is creating the resources to tap into that growth. You know, expense management, get at inefficiencies, excess layers, increased spans of control. And our last point is really on how we're exploring new spaces where the Macy's brand can compete and set up avenues of growth in the future. So I'm going to walk you through a couple of these pieces today. So let's talk first about the strength of our brand. I think what we know is that the Macy's brand has a very strong connection to the consumer and to the communities that we serve. We have the ability to deliver credible, a very emotional message with our customers that we've been part of their lives for a long time. We will be through the future. And what we also recognize is not every brand can do that. You know, most customers, we're not just a place to shop. This brand plays a role in their lives, and that presents a meaningful opportunity for us. So we have to strategize, and we have to communicate new ways, though, to amplify the strength of our brand. I think we all know that Macy's stands for sales, and we probably have too much of our promotional messaging out, and we have much more of an opportunity to play with other aspects of our brand that I'll share with you today. So getting at brand message and getting at marketing and campaign architecture is what we're really focused on right now. So take a look at this pyramid. This pyramid kind of represents really where we're going. And what you'll see on this thing is that love at the top is really the connection that our brand has with consumers. So it's emotional, it's the messages that really support the holidays. When you listen to those great best customers that we showed you a video of, when you think about the holidays that they just want to treat themselves, the iconic events, you saw the Thanksgiving Day parade and our fireworks and, you know, the opportunity to do that in a lot more stores. We have thousands of special events that we do in our buildings, and to bring the communities into our stores, that's what this layer is about. It's about love. That middle layer is one that is kind of some of our unsung heroes, and we call this the authority layer. And this is how Macy's can assert itself in the trends and the latest fashions. Our customers depend on us to curate fashion, to tell them what's important, to show them what goes with what. But then we also have categories that we dominate, that we need to crow about, and we need to have a much more always-on content that's customer-facing to really show what our opportunities to provide, you know, meaningful value to our customers are. And those categories are ones like women's shoes and dresses, fragrances, you know, furniture and mattresses, the men's area I talked about. Those are all categories that would fit into the authority layer. And then what you see up there on the bottom is really what you think about is those things that are limited duration, sale events, they're limited time, but they're pricing that really drives action. And so one day sales, et cetera, would continue to fit into that layer, but you're gonna see us play with this and getting the values right, less complicated. We're gonna simplify our pricing, and then the marketing spend is gonna change over the years. You're gonna see much more, let me go back, you're gonna see much more in this that's related to how we're gonna amplify the first top layers while maintaining the weight of the value layer. And what I'd love to do is share with you, this whole campaign will start in the fall season. You'll start to see it in September. And I'm gonna show you something that we just ran in spring that it's gonna feel like when you think about the love layer. So let's cue the video to show you Celebrate.
You'll never feel happy until you try. You'll never feel happy.
That gives you an example of where the brand expression will be going in the future. So let's talk. The next point is really on the products that she loves. And exclusive styles, great brands, brands found only at Macy's. You know, exclusivity can be a double-edged sword. If you just have something that's exclusive in your brand and customers don't want it, then that's deadly, because then you have the full brunt of liquidating those products. That never works. What we start with is what the customer wants and what they need. And we have the best opportunity to create that for them with our own brands and our own talent. And so we've had a lot of emphasis on this with our private brands over the past year and a half, making sure that we have the right brands for the right customer types, we've got the right price lanes, we're spending a lot of time on value, decreasing supply chain, work with smaller or fewer suppliers, making a more meaningful business with the ones that remain. We made a lot of headway here, and our brands are strong there. We're also focused on what we do with some of the exclusive brands that are more household names. So when we get it right, it's an absolute home run. We've got a home run love fest going on right now with Tommy Hilfiger. This is a brand that has been around for a while, but great talent. The marketing of this is brilliant. There's some connections with some, you know, what's the zeitgeist and some of the pop culture items that are going on. You've got people like Gigi Hadid that are involved with it. But the core of it is that the products are fantastic. And our teams have really worked with our manufacturing partners to get that. And having that only at Macy's just gives us a point of differentiation that we know when it's right, it really works. We just made an announcement of what we were going to do with DKNY. So DKNY was a brand, this was under negotiation for, you know, over a year for us to get what we believed was the right expression of this brand in the right number of categories, again, to get it right at Macy's, but we started with the customer. What was a white space for us? What was a lane that we could play? What price points did we want to be at for what customers and what wearing occasions? So when we do that right, it works. And sometimes there are these long lead times, and sometimes it's these long relationships. In a lot of cases, it's just what you want to do for a moment. And so we call those our capsules. And so a lot of retailers do this. We've made this our own. You know, we've got new brands coming in all the time. You know, Cynthia Rowley's about to do a capsule for us. You know, we've got one from Avec La Fille. We have one right now on our floor from Y-E-Gal that has been a big success. Then we go to things like Ralph Lauren and we'll say, create a capsule for us that is about the Olympics or is about some pop culture moment. And they'll do that for us. So we work a lot with exclusive product with non-exclusive brands. So that's what this whole layer means, but it starts with the customer. It starts with the DNA of these customers, their needs, and making sure that the brands represent that. And then if it's exclusive, that's an added plus. So I think this was the subject of the conference yesterday about every experience matters. And I think that it's been raised for all of us, as I said earlier. We say every experience matters because it does. And, you know, I think having the right size and color, having a smooth transaction, making sure something ships on time, those are table stakes. And all retailers have got to get that right. And we fall down all the time, and we score big when we do, when we get it right. But it's beyond that now. I think all of us know that when you talk about experience, this is about what you can do to get people into stores. You know, that's a critical, when you look at the math of when you have a stores base that is declining and you've got a digital base that is increasing, you've got variable costs on the latter and you've got fixed costs on the former, and the math won't work. You won't be as profitable if you don't figure out a way to get your store base more productive. And so we're spending a lot of time trying to figure this out, and it's all on this subject. So, and to do that, there, you know, a customer's not going to put up with a 20th century paradigm of the way you merchandise a store. They're going to look at what can you do with eateries, what can you do with entertainment, what can you do with special events. Our brand is well positioned to absorb a lot of those ideas, and how we do it, how we test it, how we scale it is going to be our journey. So we think about our best customer. We think about her on this conversation. She's an optimist. And every time she walks into a Macy's, she expects something good to happen, and we can't afford to disappoint her. So this is something that I think all retailers look at it, but this is a big opportunity for Macy's, and we're very focused on this. I think this is really why when you think about the connection that we all have as an omnichannel retailer, is I think our sweet spot as an omnichannel retailer is this combination of technology and the human connection. And that's a competitive advantage. You know, what technology makes possible and what a sales associate can make personal is a meaningful competitive advantage. And at our best, we do this well. And I think on the digital side, you know, with Terry's leadership a number of years ago, back when we had mail and telephone out of Sacramento and we saw this digital, you know, business, this was 15, 17 years ago, is we really looked at we were going to be a digital first play here. And so we started to build that. And we have maintained very good prowess on that. You know, we're ranked by L2 as the second best department store on this. About 2 years ago, we said that the juice, the lifeblood of the business is going to go through mobile, and we decided to really make a mobile-first initiative, and we put a lot of resources against this. And Ansible just ranked the Macy's app, the mobile app, as the best in the nation. So much of our business is now being transacted through that. So we've got a strong digital platform. We've got a strong mobile platform. We're really working on stores. We've got unbelievable flagships. We've got other stores that we're now investing in. That is the competitive advantage of technology and the human connection that an omnichannel retailer can play with. But it does speak to the critical role of stores. So I mentioned this earlier, but this is a major intersection for our customers. You know, we still have 80% of our consumers that prefer to try products on in stores. And we also have, and this is obviously the bane sometimes of our pure play competitors about what they do with returns. And 3 out of 4 returns, a customer prefers to return that into a store. So it's a huge opportunity for you to convert that return into something that she wants. It's a huge opportunity to take some piece of that digital demand and move it into the store through a buy online, pick up in store. And once they're in the store, they buy a lot of other things. So we're always looking for ways, basically, to enhance traffic in our stores. Right now, what Macy's is working on is what does our next generation of stores look like? And will they be smaller? Will they be more digitally enabled? What are those businesses where customers just want a speedy checkout and they don't want to interface with a customer? How do you enable that with your mobile app? What are those businesses that through your mobile app as your guide, you can learn everything you want to about that product that you need. You can learn everything you need to about customer reviews. And what are those businesses where you really need that human touch, where you need that advisor, where you need to work on that engagement ring together as you're customizing, you know, your stone with your setting? You know, what are those businesses where you need that human touch, and what are those businesses where, frankly, technology needs to serve you? That's what we're getting at to with our next generation of stores. So expect us. We're launching one right now, getting some good results. We have concept boards on others, but we want to walk out of this year with a much better idea about what it's going to take for us to be much more competitive in getting our store business at a healthier pace. To that is really something that I'm proud of, that I think this is something we do well, which is testing, iterating, and scaling. In our company, we don't do much without making sure it's in front of the customer first and that we're making the adjustments, we're reiterating from that, we roll out the next generation, we iterate again, and I want to give you a couple examples of where we've done that. So that image on the left is to represent our fine jewelry business. And fine jewelry was a business that, when you looked at the jewelry business at Macy's, we had about a 5% market share nationwide, and it was different depending on each of the pieces. And so you have millennials that we had made a big push for over the years. And when you looked at our bridal registry, about 50% of the new brides that were registering with us had never been in a Macy's before. They'd never experienced Macy's in the past, 50%. So then we looked at where that journey starts from the bridal registry, and it really started with the ring. And that's the first major decision. After the color of the wedding, and they do all the tear sheets and the Pinterest, but they do start with the ring. Did Macy's have a viable engagement ring business? And while we had a 5% share in overall jewelry, we only had a 1% share, actually a little less than that, in engagement rings. So we had to, what were all the impediments of us being, we had some formidable specialty store competitors, but how could we get serious about that business? So we just took that business apart, and we basically treated it like we do our lease businesses. We basically put firewalls around that entire business and said, what would it take? And the first thing that we did is we weren't competitive in assortment. So we said, we don't have enough loose stones. We don't have enough of an assortment. We need to get more brands. So we completely, basically transferred all of the goods back to a vendor community, rebought higher priced goods that had more value in them, gave us larger assortments. That's how we played with the assortment side and played with our AUR, our average unit retail, by taking that up by about 25 points. Then we looked at what we did in our environment, and did we have the right case lines and the right propping and the right lighting and enough case lines to be able to showcase what was right in this business. Then we looked at our sales associates. Did we have enough? In some cases, we doubled the amount of sales associates indoors. Did we have the right commission structures? Did we have the right compensation that would attract big guns from some of the competitors? We put that in place. We then dedicated store management. Then we dedicated training management to be able to put around this business. And then we looked at trunk shows to be able to add pageantry and special events and new content into these buildings. And lastly, we played with marketing. And when we did that, we started in actually the Southwest region here. We played with 40 doors. And it worked. You know, we put all these assets against it. It worked. It needed to have a high ROI to justify all those investments, and it worked. We made some tweaks. We then rolled it out to an entire region. Then we made more tweaks. And right now, I'm proud to say that by the August of this year, every single store in the company is going to have what I've just described as part of our fine jewelry business. And I'm also happy to say that we're now taking market share again from that formidable competitive, you know, cycle of the specialty stores. So we know that when you've got this business where that human touch is really important, that and there are some, it's not all, that we can to take this approach and do it well. So if you look at the right side, you know, I'm biased on this because I'm a department store person, but I still think that department stores is the best place for women to buy shoes. And when you look at the assortment, I think that there's nothing that can beat a department store. So when you look back in 2015, Macy's was not winning in this business. We were losing market share. So we had in flight what we were doing in fine jewelry. We then said, what could we do in women's shoes? Same, we went back, this time we took 50 stores. We went back to the Southwest, and we started playing with it. And we said, first off, let's be in size and color. Let's have table stakes. So we really edited the assortment. Let's think about this not from a brand architecture, but from a classification architecture. How many black pumps do you need? And so we started to play with that. We said, these are the brands that are going to stand the test of time. Let's keep them separate. But everything else, let's classify it. Let's play, because of DSW, let's play with open sell. Let's play with an amazing back of house. Let's have dedicated sales associates that are on commission at rates that they weren't before. Gave us the opportunity to recruit people. We play with enhanced management, training, same thing. And this one was even better than that one. And we're now rolling that out to the entire country after going from just that Southwest test. So that'll be in all stores by September. So two important business for us. But the most important comment I'm making is just this idea about testing, iterating, and then scaling, and making sure that everybody in the company is galvanized in their role in doing that when we do it. So I want to tell you next about one that is a work in progress that you've heard about Macy's getting into, which is really the whole realm of off-price. So here you have how we look at off-price. So there's two comments. Backstage is off-price, last act is clearance. And I want to talk about backstage. So backstage for us, first off, again, it started with the consumer. So if you looked at that best customer that we saw, two-thirds of that best customer is shopping at off-price virtually every month. Two-thirds. So in the same reason we made a decision about really building a very powerful digital website was we could have lost a market share to a competitor or we could lose it to ourselves. That's always kind of the argument. So we look at why lose that customer to an off-price competitor who are formidable, we all know who they are, if we could potentially retain them for our own brand. And how might we do that? We started with Backstage as a freestanding concept. And that quickly morphed into how we take Backstage and put it into our underproductive buildings, our buildings that have space and have customers that are telling us that they would love those opportunities. And the first thing we looked at was whatever we put in that building that's in Backstage, we really want to minimize the amount of cannibalization for the products that are in the balance of the store. So we spent a lot of time on this, and we really looked at discrete categories that were new to the building. We looked at value bands and lanes that we wanted to traffic in. So we're now in about 15 doors. It's going well. We're lifting the entire building by the rate that we expected. We're now adding another 30. We're playing with different scenarios with this on the last X side in combinations. But at the end of the day, we want to walk out of 2017 with a scalable model for future years that can express what our customers want, which is off-price, with the advantage of it being on mall now. So there's obviously, when you think about our competitors in off-price, they're in strip malls, they're off-mall. Can there be an off-price option all-mall that is within a Macy's store? We're going to find out. We're going to test. We're going to iterate. We're going to scale if it works. So we're not declaring victory on this, but wanted you to know that we're going to take the same disciplines that we did with fine jewelry and shoes with respect to this business. So those things I've just talked about in the past may have been enough to basically hit what we expect to hit. I don't think in these secular changes that we have in our industry that it would be enough. And so we're putting a real premium on what's new and what's next. So when you look at all the retail upheaval, we really had to look outward and to see where that growth would be. And so what I would say is that I'll go back on this. The luck for us is that our brand has the flexibility to do this. You know, when I was starting in this business, I was an electronics buyer, and Macy's was the number one electronics purveyor in the country. And that was before a lot of the big boxes came in. So before Best Buy, and at that point, Circuit City and the good guys and the regional players. But when you think about the amount of categories that used to be, and you think about a department store really being a mini mall, the opportunity is, and our customer gives us permission to be, in a lot of businesses that we're not currently. And we now have a lease model that gives us another hybrid economic model to be able to do that. So when you think about our success with Lens Crafters, which is a service business, 2 to 3 visits to complete your transaction, lots of other opportunities for that customer to shop your doors, we're looking at that. I think the bottom line on this one is we're looking for new avenues where Macy's can transact beyond our digital boundaries and beyond our store boundaries. So we're looking for new businesses, new models, new partnerships. We now have a dedicated team that is focused on this because we believe we're going to need that. And so we're right now incubating all that. We're prioritizing that. We're looking for some quick wins. We're looking for some long-term plays. Not ready to announce what any of that is right now, but know that we're hard at work at this. What's new? What's next? So that's how we're reimagining Macy's. I would say overall, our head is not in the sand. You know, we're looking outward. We're looking for solutions there. We've got a team that we've got a brand that is amazing. We've got a strategy that we are working through. We've got a team that is used to winning and ready to win again, but is humble and looking outward as much as we all are. So that's what we're here to do. That's how we're going to lead this. And with that, I'll open it up for questions. Anybody has questions? We have the lights on.
Hi.
Tell us who you are and what you do.
Is it on? Oh, it's on.
It's on.
Okay. Okay, so I am a student here in the U of A retailing program, and I can probably speak on behalf of every student here that we're very honored to be here, and Terry is the sole reason that we get to do so. So my question is for you, what do you plan on doing, not for just us as students in the U of A retailing program, but for every student who is aspiring to enter this industry at this time?
Yeah, it's a great question. I had a good conversation with Marissa and Scott yesterday about, you know, what I see is how do we continue Terry's legacy? Are there other spots where we would do that? Are there other states we may do that? That's under discussion. But what I would say is that there is a huge premium that continuing education doesn't just stop when you're ready to go to, you know, your first job, but it's within new companies. And I'm looking right now, and I'm looking at New York City, and I'm seeing assistant buyers and associate buyers, and they may be of different talents, and just fundamentals about what they need to learn about consumer insights and analytics and how they plan assortments and how they negotiate, you know, tough deals and how they're always going to be responsible or responsive to a customer is going to involve a level of education that is, we do some of it well, some of it is a gap. And so I believe we have a huge opportunity with continuing education with our teams. And then obviously when you look at the font of candidates that come through retailers like Macy's, we have to make sure that's seeded. We have to support programs like the Terry Lundgren School for Retailing because you're our future. And when I look at the caliber of candidates that I'm hearing about or seeing, you know, that gives you a lot of optimism about the future of our business. And so we have to make those investments. We have to make sure we have the right source of incoming talent. And, you know, I came up to the training program. You know, any executive is on executive committee. I think there's 10 on executive committee, and I think 9 of them came through a training program. So that path, I think, is evergreen. I don't think you can bring people, you know, some of our players have been brought from other companies because they have lenses, but they all came through training programs where they were. So I think it's important.
Hey there, John Bebo with the Independent College Bookstore Association. You talked about editing assortments.
Yes.
And kind of rationalizing things. How do you accomplish that without limiting innovation and limiting risk-taking that could be productive?
Yeah, what I'd say is that actually by editing, it creates risk-taking and innovation. You know, when you look at a lot of big retailers, they have deals with their wholesale partners. There's packages that you buy together. There's a reconciliation period about the margins at the end of those. And so there's sometimes within all those, that assortment is a lot of pablum. It's a lot of duplication. It's a lot of duplicative key items. So we talk about going from the layer cake of basics, key items, and fashion to a cupcake, having a really well-built set of basics that are on replenishment that you have in size and color at the store level, and then amazing fashion that your buyers love and they put in every single store. And that frosting is really important in the business where pricing and commodity pricing is so transparent, you'll never win with that. So if you don't create desire, if you don't create new ideas that customers see more frequently in your stores, you're going to retard innovation. You're going to retard experimentation. So I think editing is the juice that will give us that.
Hey, my name is Sean Harris. I'm with Zebra Technologies, the North American retail industry lead there. There's a lot of talk about investment in technology, but it always comes back to culture, right, in terms of how you execute and how your people are thinking about things. What is that famous saying that culture eats strategy for breakfast,
yes,
right?
Yes.
What are you guys doing around culture, around training your people to think differently about what you need to do to win?
I think it's a great question, and I would tell you it's a work in progress. You know, and it's what's interesting about, I think, as any large company, it really depends on what pyramid you're in about where your culture is and how it is and how it behaves. So I was just in San Francisco, which is really where our digital innovation happens. And that culture is, I'd stack it up against any company in terms of a culture that is, I was in a meeting as an example, and they had this thing called Stop Jump, which is basically where anybody who is on a project, we do obviously Idea Labs and Lean Labs. It's all agile development that comes out of our San Francisco branch. And so they get on these 1 week and 2 week sprints of how they develop software. And so I was in a meeting with the upper management of that, and there was a woman who knocked on the door. She looked to me like, she looked like you. And she was probably like 22, 23. That's, you know, she turned out that she was actually 26. And she basically was asking for a $5 million. She was jumping over 3 other levels of management to ask the decision maker for that. That's their culture. And the management that she was jumping over had no idea what her project was, but they trusted that she was so close to that project, and the decision maker was the one that she was requesting it of. And so what you have in that culture is that the levels and the bureaucracy of layers and of that organization are really blurred. And everybody has a voice. Everybody has a discrete role of getting what they need done because it's set up that way and the culture permits that. There's other cultures where that would not be easy today for us, where you need all that management oversight and the GVP, you know, is approving what the VP did and the SVP is then approving that, and it just takes time and it's way too laborious. You know, what I call our culture in some of its pockets is that we're a culture of over-preparedness. And we have an opportunity to get all of our concepts in front of the customer much faster and then iterating. That whole concept of testing and iterating and scaling. But we're not there yet. So part of it is for us is really looking at, do we have too many layers? And so we basically took 2 layers across all of the pyramids out of the organization back in January. Part of it is we expanded the scale of the number of direct reports that each of those executives have. And right now we're working on what's their discrete role. Are there processes where the role clarification is not clear? There's no one responsible. There's no one who's holding themselves accountable to it. How do we get that cleaned up? So work in progress. I've got this. the cut. Yes.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
I grew up at Macy's.
You grew up at Macy's?
I grew up at Macy's. Long ago and
you
far
still shop there, I hope?
Long ago and far away. That's another conversation. Long ago and far away, I was a little girl from New Jersey. My name was Mary Kelly. I lived at 444 Elm Street. My dad had never gone to college. My mother didn't drive. Macy's provided the Macy's training program, and the Macy's experience literally created a life for me that I never even imagined. I didn't imagine it because I didn't have any models to see it. I think it would be really valuable if you could tell the group a little bit about the training program and how it prepares people for a career in retail, because you guys are the only ones that still really do it. And I'm here to tell you that I live a life that, again, I never imagined because of my experience at Macy's. I actually skipped a bachelor's degree and was able to go directly to a master's degree. Wow. Because of the training program that was done by Mike Steinberg's wife. And so it's a story that is actually very dear to my heart, the whole Macy's training program and the experience of getting on planes and meeting CEOs of companies in Korea and India, things that you can't study in school. Jeff, could you just tell the group a little bit about that?
I think you said it well. I don't know what I would add to that. I think it's... But I would, to the earlier question about, you know, talent being the lifeblood of our future, is we do have a rich training program. And I think we're a very active recruiter in many campuses across the company or across the country, like U of A here, and making sure that we've got the best possible talent. And once they hit, a lot of times we have exposure to them because they're interns for us. So they have a trial run with us. You know, they get to test things out with us in either the stores organization or, you know, in New York City. And it gives our management an opportunity to really see the bright bulbs. And then we've got all the recommendations that come out of the schools that talk about their talent. We do a lot of presentations that give them opportunities to kind of show up. But I think the beauty of Macy's and what it's always been and what it will always be is the opportunity of diversity of position and the opportunities to be able to go from customer analytics, to go into marketing, to go into planning, to be able to go into asset management. And the ability to basically go into stores, we still have that in some cases. So this opportunity of being able to give people at a very young age lots of experiences that gives them the ability to see the customer from many different lenses, if they're in a support role or they're in a merchant role, in a driving role, and it also gives them exposure to lots of diverse talent, and it builds reputations. And that's why people stay, because it's never the same, it's always different, and they have the opportunity to control their own destiny. So I think what you experienced back in New Jersey is one that we do today. And different permutations, but that will continue. That's our commitment to the industry. It's our commitment to our customer. Thank you, everybody.